So welcome everyone to getting to know the GCAR leadership team. But before I hand over, I wanted to give everyone some context. So when I joined Cure Brain Cancer Foundation in January of 2021, the number one thing the community said was, GCAR, we have to bring it to Australia. So what I'm excited to share today is that we're going to have the dynamic CEO, Meredith Buxton, and her wonderful rockstar leadership team give us updates, which you, the community, over the past 3 weeks shared were the most important. I met with 300 community members over the first 3 months, and everyone came up to me and said, Lance, Cure Brain Cancer Foundation has been making this promise since 2013, and 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. So I made a promise to all of you that I will give as much transparency as I can. But before we do that, I want to hand over again to the rockstar CEO, Meredith Buxton.
Thanks, Lance. Thanks for the opportunity to share updates on our progress. So before we start, I'm going to tell you a little bit about our organization. I think it's helpful to understand who we are and why we're doing what we do. So GCAR, or Global Coalition for Adaptive Research, is a nonprofit research delivery organization. We serve as the sponsor for these innovative trials, GBM Agile being our most notable one, but we serve in an honest broker capacity. Our role is to really bring together the community, the scientific leadership in the space, the patient organizations who often, like yourselves at Cure Brain Cancer Foundation, serve as some of the seed funders for our initiatives, as well as the pharma or industry to try to move forward advancements in drug development to support the patients. We are not an organization that implements these. Sometimes the term is a contract research organization or CRO. That is not our role. Our role is to work closely with our CRO or other vendor partners to implement these efforts. But again, we're really trying to bring together the community to take an issue or question and help move it forward in a more expeditious fashion. So before we start, I'd like to introduce you to our team.
I'm Ashley Powell, and I'm Executive Director for Trial Operations at GCAR with a primary focus on GBM Agile. So it's so exciting to get to be able to speak to you, get to introduce you to our team, and just talk to you about how much we've grown and what we're capable of doing now.
Hi, I'm Sarah Untch. I'm the Associate Director of Trial Operations of GBM Agile, and so I oversee the global operations for GBM Agile. And what that means is I oversee some of the strategy for GBM Agile and all of the little bits and pieces that make GBM Agile run.
Yeah, hi there. My name's Kate Bryant Greenwood. I am one of the two operations managers assigned to GBM Agile. I assist Sarah in overseeing really our trial activities, ensuring safety and conduct. And I am going to be focusing on opening up the study in Australia.
So these questions were the five top most asked questions at our community events. Can you provide a brief overview of the trial and explain why it's so groundbreaking?
I think it's important to understand context and some of the challenges that we see in clinical research. So drug development is a long and costly process. It can take billions of dollars, many years to bring a single drug to market. And while traditional randomized controlled trials are really considered sort of the gold standard, they've been fairly inefficient or limited in the questions that they ask. And that can really impede the development and timely delivery of new devices, new investigational drugs to patients. And then you layer in that our understanding of the biology of cancer has increased. And so that is adding in more complexity to the questions that we need to ask and a need to have better clinical trials. And then you take into the consideration what's going on in the glioblastoma space, which is that most trials in GBM have failed. They're viewed pretty high risk by the drug development community. And that's because of some of the biological factors, the need for drugs to pass through the blood-brain barrier. There's some drug resistance issues, et cetera, and then trial factors. Just, it's very costly to run trials. Sometimes we've not designed them in the best way possible. And so what we need to do is to think about how to create an innovative solution to this. And that's where GBM Agile comes in. This idea of not needing to recreate the wheel for each trial, that we could assemble the experts in the field. We could work with the regulators like the Federal Drug Administration in the US to iron out any details around it. And we could create an ongoing infrastructure. We could build a trial once and use it many times. What we found is that in most clinical trials, while they're, again, well-designed, the idea of building a trial, asking a question, tearing it down, and then building it again is a very slow and costly process. And our hope was to create really a turnkey solution for drug development, really lowering the bar to participation by companies to be in the space. And at the same time, create a very patient-centric model, a model that patients would sort of think would be the type of trial they want to be in, where we understand which drugs are performing well quickly, we put patients on the better performing drugs, they have an increased likelihood of doing that, and that's all within the GBM Agile platform. So GBM Agile is an international effort focusing on both newly diagnosed and recurrent glioblastoma. It is a master protocol, which is a structure in which many experimental arms are compared against the standard of care or a common control, and arms can enter and exit at different times based on a decision algorithm. We use the primary endpoint of overall survival, and why that's important is we are looking to find not only important signals in the space, but to confirm those signals and use the totality of that data for a new approval or a regulatory filing. And so using an outcome measure like overall survival is important to be able to do that. And like I said, it's a collaboration between some of the experts in the space, some of the key opinion leaders in the field, as well as with important patient organizations like Cure Brain Cancer Foundation, and also the clinical and scientific community beyond just our clinical investigators. And so GBM Agile is really designed to be this long-standing evergreen effort where we can quickly evaluate how drugs are performing and move those forward for approvals as fast as we can.
What steps are being taken to open the trial in Australia?
So I oversee the global expansion of GBM Agile and recently oversaw the expansion of GBM Agile into Europe. Currently, GBM Agile is open in the United States, Canada, France, Switzerland, and we're looking forward to expanding into Germany and Australia. So when I think about starting up a trial, what I think about is ensuring patient safety. And ensuring patient safety on a clinical trial requires coordinating a whole team, really a trial ecosystem that's being built to support the trial for years to come. So where we are right now with Australia is we're building some of that infrastructure to support the trial.
Yeah, and just to expand on what Sarah was describing, that infrastructure, for those who may not know, there are just many subgroups and teams of people that work, such as ourselves, behind the scenes that are part of the broader scope of the trial itself. If you're a patient on a clinical trial, sometimes we think that it's really the treating physician or nurse only that are managing our care. But in fact, there are multiple teams that are working behind the scenes. For example, we have teams besides the hospital sites, the site staff, the research pharmacists, your physician, your treating investigators. We have teams of ethics reviewers who ensure the safety of the trial participants. They review and monitor research involving people. This includes all biomedical research, such as clinical trials, to ensure that patient safety. There's also teams of data scientists. They create study plans and review trial findings and ongoing safety as well. And let's not forget pharmaceutical companies who are really in the business of developing new drugs. And these drugs are then supplied to GBM Agile to be included in our trial. As well as we can't forget the patient advocates. They really are the ones that are help champion clinical trials in general, as well as innovated and new patient-centric trials such as GBM Agile.
Why are clinical trials such as GBM Agile for glioblastoma brain tumors so important?
Glioblastoma, as many of us know, is a devastating, aggressive disease. Despite surgery, chemotherapy, and radiation, median survival is really less than 15 months. And unlike more common cancers, treatment for brain cancer just really has improved very little in recent decades. And it's only through clinical trials that we can find safe and effective treatments that work better than our current treatments. The new treatments, we have to remember, being tested now, today, will be the standard of care and evidence-based care 10 years from now. And with GBM Agile, our trial and this new type of design, we are really trying to shorten that time frame.
So the next question is the most asked question out of all the community events. So what are the next steps toward opening this trial in Australia?
So to open a trial of this complexity, there are a lot of moving parts. And I think one of the most important is our physicians that are participating as researchers for this trial. They have been incredibly enthusiastic. They've been so supportive. And so we are currently evaluating multiple sites across Australia for their capabilities to run a trial of this complexity. And so that is ongoing now. We are also working on the other aspects of running a trial, such as making sure that we have these pharmaceutical drugs on the continent, ready to go for the patients there. We have laboratories that are ready to go. We have the teams that will be reviewing the brain imaging also ready to go. So there are multiple factors here, but I will say that we have had great buy-in by the investigators in Australia. You know, so excited, as everyone's mentioned, that we haven't had the innovation in GBM that you have seen in other cancers. I know we've all worked in oncology for many years, and you've seen progress in treating numerous cancers, more targeted therapies, better outcomes for patients. And we haven't had that for GBM. And so that's why GBM Agile is so exciting to bring to a worldwide audience and to patients, that we can really advance treatment in this for years to come. I'd also like to point out that we are looking at sites across Australia to make it easier for patients to find something closer to them. We know that participating in clinical research can be very challenging for patients and their caregivers. You know, you might have to see your physician more frequently, have more labs, more scans, and that can be really challenging for patients. So we want to be geographically more available to more people so that it is easier for them to come and participate, and that, you know, they know that they can be getting these opportunities to be in this trial without as much stress to try and travel more frequently. So we're really excited about being able to do that too.
What most excites you about GCAR's partnership with Cure Brain Cancer Foundation?
Since Lance, you and I have been fortunate enough to be working together for over a year now, and we've been working closely with the Cure Brain Cancer Foundation to try and bring GBM Agile to Australia for some time. I will say that the partnership with key organizations like yours are critical to an organization like ours. We really feel that in order to lower the bar for company participation, and that these trials are only as good as the drugs that we can bring forward in these efforts, but to lower that bar to participation is to create an infrastructure that's already standing that the companies can plug into. And so an organization like yours can really provide that critical and vital seed funding that we need to build out the infrastructure in Australia or in other regions. Additionally, it's important for us, as I've said before, to work closely with the patient organizations to really make sure that we are supporting the patient voice. We do feel the design is very patient-centric, as I've said before. We are not only learning quickly which drugs perform well and which drugs perform poorly and change the assignments for patients, increase their probability or likelihood to be assigned to better performing drugs that better match their biology or subtype, and decrease the probability of being assigned drugs that don't match as well. We also are giving patients an opportunity to try a lot of investigational drugs. So what does that mean? In a trial like this, it's not just we compare against a standard of care. And we know the standard of care has not been as effective for most patients. But patients have a much increased chance of getting assigned a treatment, 80% likelihood of, or 80% chance of being assigned an investigational drug above and beyond the standard of care. So again, we design this to be very patient-centric, but we always want to make sure the patient voice is in there, and the way that we enroll patients, we consent them, we inform them, we update them. And having a partnership with Cure Brain Cancer Foundation and other patient organizations ensures that patient voice is always throughout everything we do in terms of our implementation and ongoing development of these efforts.
And on behalf of the entire Australian community, brain cancer community, I want to thank you, Meredith, Ashley, Sarah, Kate, Rachel, who's not on the screen, We can't thank you enough, and I look forward to welcoming you to Australia when we get the first site up and running. Thank you again.
But we want to thank you. I think your determination, and you really pushed this forward in a way that has moved it along much faster. And so I know that the community has felt that things have not moved as quickly as they hoped. We really did need to create the foundation globally and then bring it to Australia. But you've been heroic in your efforts to really push this forward in Australia, and we really appreciate your support.